I received that word, and that's what he's burning in my spirit. He's been preparing people for a long time for a lot of different things. And I can't speak for all of you, but for me, we're in it. We're in it right now. We're in some stuff right now. We're in that time where the Lord is, he's moving, and it's exciting to be in that place, you know, where the Lord is. And hallelujah. Well, you know that he's leading you and guiding you. It just changes you, transforms you, motivates you. It really does. And I have a message today that's been growing in my spirit all week long. Started Monday when we were working on those floors for my wife, and oh man, that was fun. The Lord started giving me this word, this revelation. He says, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith? Will he find faith? How many want to make sure that when he comes, he's going to find faith in you? Yeah. Amen. You guys are in the right place. Yeah. And this is pulled out of that parable of the persistent widow. And I'm just going to just start off with this and just kind of lay down a little foundation here and then build. And I have some really, I think it's really good revelation today that I think can help encourage, stir us if we're not already, operating in faith and going for the things of the kingdom, the thing that God has for us. We'll be motivated here before we're through. Hallelujah. So I want to encourage you. Thank you for coming too, by the way. Praise the Lord. So Luke 18, verse 1, our Lord was speaking a parable and saying that men ought to always pray and not to faint. And aren't you glad we can get in that place where we can pray? And when circumstances look like they're going to do you in, you're not going to faint. There's power not to faint. Aren't you glad? Amen. And then it starts talking about verse 2, there was in a city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him saying, avenge me of mine adversary. Oh man, anybody got an adversary that's trying to mess with you and hinder you and all that stuff? We all do, right? And it's just a great little parable here. And it says in verse 4 that he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, though I fear not God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. And the Lord says, hear what the unjust judge said. And then he gives the analogy, our God is just, right? It says, and shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? You heard a little testimony from my wife. That was a 10-year-old deal where she was standing and believing, contending for that breakthrough. You know what? But it came, right? Or whatever it may be in your case. He says, I tell you, he will avenge him speedily. And then he says something here. When he says these kinds of things, you know, it makes me think, well, why are you saying that, Lord? And does that pertain to me? And nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, shall he find faith on the earth? Oh, man. Yeah, that's a big deal right there. And I believe he is. How many believe he's going to find faith in your life? Amen. I really believe he is. And so I'm going to build on last week's message. And last week, if you missed it, it was called God is with us. God is with us. And please hear that when you, I don't know about you, but when you start to come into a revelation that God is with you, it will change the way you live. It really will. In other words, here's part of the revelation. Why did God send his only begotten Son into the world? Not only to save us, but to deal with sin, to deal with the effects of sin, to deal with the mindsets of fear and mindsets of condemnation that hinder us. When you're starting to come into the revelation of the Son of God, that life of God starts manifesting to your life through faith, righteousness is revealed from faith, condemnation disappears. Fear disappears, right? Inability, your inability disappears, and his ability starts coming on you. There's a transformation at the revelation of Jesus. Isn't that the truth? And so that's part of it, but I really want to build on that today. And our foundation verse last week was Matthew 1:23, which says, "Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son. They shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God is with us." That's a powerful statement right there. There's so much revelation here and in the preceding verses that I just couldn't pass it up. I feel compelled by my spirit to really get into something that the Lord's been trying to establish in me, a revelation for years. I mean, I remember preaching on this several years ago when we started preaching out of our living room. We had a little church in our house for almost 4 years. And he started giving me this revelation. And so please hear this. God is closer. He's with us. How many believe he's with us? He's closer than a lot of people may realize, even believers. And being saved is a reality that's realized when you know you have the truth. When you have the peace of God living within you, please hear me. When you know you have the knowledge of him, there's going to be a power working within you, not only to set you free, but to keep you free. How many know what I'm talking about? And this is a big deal, praise the Lord. But so often I see people, they're sidelined. I mean, some of the nicest, sweetest people you ever met are sidelined by the enemy some way, somehow. How does it happen? I can't say I know all the answers, but they're caught unaware. They're caught by a snare, right? By the prince of the air, right? And that is just the truth, and it shouldn't be, right? When we've been given this word. And God's going to, I believe God is just stirring things up. I'm getting geared up for some new breakthrough in the future. I really believe the veils are being pulled off. I think somebody was talking about this just a little while ago, that some of those seals that have been opened in the book of Revelation, those things that Daniel talked about, we're going to see some new things come into the body of Christ. Things that are laid up for this time, for this season. That we are in and entering into a time that's like no other time. How many believe that? Well, you're going to see some stuff. Is that okay with you? The enemy's going to see some stuff too. Yeah, it's going to be good. I'm looking forward to that one. So, some kingdom stuff, right? Yeah, and so let me just kind of build on this a little bit. Praise the Lord. Turn with me to the book of Matthew, and we'll look at a few things here. Praise God. Matthew 1:23, and we're going to back up to verse 1 there. I'm going to read a few things in just a minute, but I just I want to stir you today and just encourage you, because I mean, there really is a kingdom of God that's at hand. There really is a Savior, and he is here. And I think we get caught unaware because we maybe, for whatever reason, we haven't come into that full revelation of Christ within us, the hope of glory. And I'm not saying you, but I'm telling you, you know what? Real faith is coming. God is bringing the church into a new levels, deeper levels of faith. And I believe we're going to see faith like we see in the scriptures, biblical faith, things like you see in the epistles, things that the church of Acts did. We're going to start seeing happen more and more all around the world. I really believe this. And so God is near. God is at hand. He's with you. Jesus is here through the Holy Spirit. How many believe that? And so when Satan's breathing down your neck, anybody have have that happen to you? Yeah. Just remember, God is always closer. He's always the greater one. There's always an anointing available to break those yokes, to remove those burdens from your neck. There really is. When you feel like you're almost defeated, anybody ever know what that one's like? Yeah, when it looks like there's no hope, just know that His banner over you is love just waiting to embrace you, right? Just know that He will empower you with His grace and bring to light that greater reality, that life, that righteousness of Jesus in your life to bring forth that manifestation of who you are in Christ. He's here. His grace is here. And I know we know this. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. He asked me a couple weeks ago, do you believe that I'm with you? And I said, well, yeah, I think I do. Why not? Why would you say that, Lord? And I'm telling you what, that could be a sobering question for the Lord to ask you, that kind of a question. Do we really believe that He's with us, that He's in us, that we're carrying something of Christ? I mean, if we have that knowledge that He is with us, even as He was with His Father, we could have that relationship. You think that we might live a little different than we are? What do you guys think? Yeah. I'm not here to don't get upset with me. I'm just here to stir you, encourage you. And I'm looking in the mirror. And I think there's going to be a great unveiling in the days ahead of the sons of God. And so I'm discovering that it's impossible to remain bound up in fear, to continually live a life of condemnation, hopelessness, or whatever it may be, rejection, when you're following after the Spirit. Why? Because where the Spirit of the Lord is, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty, right? We were talking last night, John Land was preaching up in Angel's Camp about Thomas Tenney. Anybody ever heard of God Chasers? And I was preaching on that a little bit. And these guys, they had some real encounters. When God showed up, church people were repenting. Save me, Lord. I think people were wanting to get baptized. People that had been in church for years. I mean, God so showed up in His presence that you knew that you knew. And John was just touching on all these revivals of what happened. I mean, when God shows up in His presence, His glory, oh man, there's a reverential fear that comes. You will find yourself in a repentive state. And I can't express that enough, you know. How many believe we need to have a visitation of the Lord in a great, tangible way? And Scripture says, you know, if His people who are called by His name will humble themselves and cry out and pray, right, He will heal them. He will hear them from heaven, heal their land. And there's hope for this nation. How many believe there's hope for this area and this nation? There really is. And I'm getting excited. I think we're going to see some really awesome things as a body of Christ start rising up in the days ahead. And I know we are. We already are. We're seeing some stuff happen. And so, hallelujah. You know, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, because the life you're living in the flesh is a life of the Son of God, right? You're living by the faith of the Son of God, right? Who died for us. And I'm telling you what, there's liberty because God is with us. As many as are led by the Spirit of the Lord, right, they are the sons of God, right? How many believe that? And so this is what I want to touch on today. And I just want to encourage people, like Genevieve was saying, if we'll just let the Holy Spirit have His way, how many are okay with that in our life, in our churches? You know what? Not only will those works of the enemy, those inroads, have to leave us, but He will keep you. He will preserve you to the point where you're going to start to know and see that greater reality within you, Christ in you, the hope of glory, come forth in a tangible way. And I think that's what's starting to happen. We're seeing Christ rise up in people and is changing things. How many believe that? All right. I'm getting excited. It's amazing. It really is. I mean, when Christ shows up in your life, you get born again. How many know that? It's like old things do pass away. If you have a good touch of the Lord, right? It can happen instantly. Sometimes it takes longer for others, but just keep going, right? Huh, Donna? I mean, I can tell you, I was a work, man, and the Lord, He changes you to the point where you don't want to live like you used to live anymore. You don't want to sin. You don't like that anymore. That's not even who you are. And God wants to lead us out of that old stuff and into who we really are. And He wants to empower us to live by grace. And so please hear me. We are the body of Christ here in this generation. How many believe that? We are the body of Christ, and we belong to Jesus. And because we belong to Him, according to Scriptures in Galatians 3:29, it says that we are the seed of Abraham, and we are joint heirs with Him. This is our privilege, every one of us, right? We are joint heirs with Christ. What does that mean? Maybe more than we have yet to experience or see, but I'm telling you what, God knows how to take you right where you are to bring you out into the fullness of who He created you to be. He really did. If He could bring Jesus Christ, you know, forth some 2,000 years ago, how many believe He knows how to bring that Son of God that He created you to be forth in this generation? How many believe that? And not only that, He considers it already done. He's made all the preparation from the foundation of the world, even. That's what the Bible says. And so looking at our text here, you know, I was looking at Matthew 1:23 last week, and I couldn't help and notice the genealogy. Anybody ever read the genealogy? I used to read that and say, what in the world is this here for? What does this mean? Used to get kind of boring. I'd just read right over it, not even understanding. I mean, I'm just being honest with you, but it's there for a reason. And when you start to discover the reason, it changes everything. It can. I'm telling you what, this can. There's some revelation in this genealogy that can put a fire in you like never before. I hope to just stir you up today. Praise the Lord. And so I'm going to look at that. How many are there? Hallelujah. Genesis or Matthew 1, right? You see this. I'll just read the first one. It says, this is the book of the generation. Please hear that word, of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. And I'm not going to go in through and read all those names. I can't even pronounce all of them, but you can read them. The point that I want to bring out here, I'll read verse 17. It says, so all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations, and from David until the carrying away of Babylon are 14 generations. Okay, and how many know that God is a number God too? Yeah, and from the carrying away into Babylon unto Christ are 14 generations. And so the Lord kind of brought me into this revelation years ago. I just had a little bit of revelation. I just knew that somehow we were connected to Christ. How many believe we are connected to Him? That somehow we are new creatures. This old person isn't who we are anymore. We are part of His body, right? Doesn't Scripture say we're bone of His bone and flesh of His flesh even? It does. I'm telling you, there's a lot of revelation. Oh, man. And so the Lord brought me into this several years ago, and I started adding these things up. And so when you add up these generations, it reveals that there are 42 in total. Okay? From Abraham. And when you add up the first two, you'll see that there are 14 in each one, right? But you add up the last one. Anybody ever add them up? There's only 13. Is that interesting? And so what happened to that 14th generation there? You know, or the 42nd generation? You know, what happened to that? And I want to kind of talk about that a little bit. And could it be that there is a generation that's going to carry the name of Jesus, that's going to be the, you know, begotten of God, that we are connected some way, somehow to all this? Wouldn't that change you a little bit when you knew Your spiritual DNA is connected to Jesus. I started looking at this. Man, this genealogy really shows a lot. It shows, that God, he went to great measures to make a way for the coming of the Lord. Great preparation went into all this to bring forth Jesus. Not only Jesus, but this benefits us as well. Because our life is hid with Christ in God, right? He is our life, right? This is a miraculous thing. So I'm gonna touch on something I don't think I've ever really heard anybody. I know people have talked about this, but I'm gonna get into some stuff today. This is maybe some new stuff for some of you. I don't know, but this goes all the way back to the beginning, where man fell from glory, where we were sold out, slaves unto sin by the first man, right? I'm not even blaming the woman. It's the first man, right? Yeah? Yeah. Okay. I'm very weak, quiet here. Yeah. Anyways, you know what happened, right? I mean, it was bad. It was really bad. And God came down and he had a little chat with the devil. And what did he say in Genesis 3:15? If you have your Bibles, you can open up there. He said, I'm going to put enmity between thee and the woman, between your seed and her seed. It shall bruise your head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. And you look around in this world today, you see that this enmity is a great reality. It seems like some of these other religious, mindsets, if you will, they are totally diametrically opposed to God's people. You know, I'm talking about the nation of Israel and the church. I mean, there's some heavy-duty persecution coming on. I mean, you know what's going on around the world. I don't even have to go there. You can see that there is a battle of the bloodline there, right? Not only that, it says that your old nature, your old man even, is at enmity. Your old thought life is at enmity. Please hear this, against who you really are. It's not even subject to the laws of the things of God. That's what the Bible says in Romans chapter 8. That's a hard thing for your mind to get a hold of. It was for mine, and I'm still, having to tell my mind to shut up, It says, you're dead, I've been buried with the Lord in baptism, right? And we can live by the power of his resurrection. That's just the truth. And the Holy Spirit's here. The same power that raised him from the dead can empower us to walk in the newness of life. Aren't you glad for the power of the cross? Amen. If you missed last week, we really touched on that quite a bit. And I'm going to have that posted this week on our website. But I'm telling you what, you'll see that. You can see that this battle between the bloodline was so fierce that the enemy started coming in. In the book of Genesis, you'll see that there was the fallen angels were having relations with the women of the children of men, it says in Scripture. This is Genesis chapter 6. And there came out of that union, Nephilim, giants. God did not create the giants. It says God created man and woman. But there were some ungodly relations. It brought forth a mixture in the seed. It got so bad that God had to wipe out the earth with the flood. Oh, man. How many believe that? And there's been a battle. Even today, we're starting to see this in this generation. It says in Scripture, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. And we can see this in so many different ways, how our food is being tampered with, the genetic code. A man, people are playing with the geno. And there's some weird stuff happening right now. And I think the enemy is behind the scenes doing more than we may realize. And I mean, look at all the, I don't know why I'm going off on this, look at all the movies, all the super human movies, the mutated people, the Batmans, the guy with the claws, what was he called? X-Men. And all these different Spider-Man, yeah, Superman, and they got all kinds of them, right? you know what? There's something coming on this earth, and it's going to be. I can't say it's going to be giants again, but there is a mixture in the sea. People, it's already happening. It really is. I won't go down that path. But if you want to know more about that, I'll just throw this out there. You can go watch an interview on Sid Roth with a guy named Tom Horn. And Sid Roth talked about this a little bit a year or so ago. And there's a lot of things that you can find out about this. There's a lot of weird stuff out there too, but there's some real straight shooters that talk about this. But how many realize that God put that genealogy there the way he did for a reason? You know, he protected the bloodline. The bloodline, he did this so that you could be pure. So when you became born again, you could become transformed. You could be renewed in the mind, where you could have clarity, where you could have a pure heart, and so that you could know God. Isn't that what it says? That you can pray the prayer of faith with mustard seed faith, and mountains would be moved. And that mustard seed, I used to really chew on that for a while. Why is it mustard seed? And I discovered many, yeah. And that's what our Lord says in Scripture. He says, if your eye is single, your whole body will be filled with light, Matthew 6:22. But if it's double, it's going to be filled with darkness. And how great is that darkness? You know, he says, you know, he wants us to have his wisdom, his guidance, but he says, ask in faith, right? He wants you to have faith. He doesn't want you to waver and be tossed to and fro. You know, a lot of people are tossed to and fro because they're wavering. But you know what? When you're really sincere, you're gonna let the Lord be the Lord. You know, let him have his way and bring you through whatever it is. You're going to see the manifestation of these promises in your life. Hallelujah. Hope I'm stirring you guys up here. Okay. All right. So you can see there's a scarlet thread all the way from the beginning all the way through. And what that means to us is what I hope to just touch on at least today in a little bit, just enough to stir you up. And maybe this is going to be a two-part message. I don't know. But I got a lot. I can't get it all out. There's no way. So how many is okay with that? All right. Amen. All right. So let's dig into this a little bit more. Genesis 3:15, he'll put enmity between thee and the woman. Oh, man. Her seed. And aren't you glad we can be part of his seed, right? Yeah. The next verse, Genesis 3:16, he gives another sign there, you know, how pain women are going to, you know, have sorrow in birth. And I believe that's a sign too. I can't really get into that today. That's a sign for the times that's coming. Because as it was in the days of Noah, right, there was a lot of stuff going on, and there's a lot of shaking, there's a lot of labor pains going on in this generation. And you're going to see that there's something inside every one of you that's coming forth. How many believe that? That God is going to bring forth this greater reality within you, Christ in you, in the days ahead. So if you're going through some stuff, just keep on going, okay? God knows how to bring them forth. And we need to see the Lord. And so I want to kind of look at a few verses here, and then I'll get into a few more things that just really lay it out real clear that Jesus indeed is the seed of the woman that bruised the serpent's head. But not only that, but there's scriptures that connect us to this as well. Does that sound good? Okay. So you can see Colossians chapter 2, verse 15. You can see that the Lord through the cross, what he did to the enemy. He says he spoiled the principalities and the powers. He made a show of them openly triumphing over them in the cross. That's what it's talking about there. He disarmed the principalities for your benefit. He made a way for you to be free so that you can know him, to know the Father, to know the love of God. And he gave you that spirit of power and love so that you can have that sound mind. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad? Yeah. And so he disarmed the principalities that everybody, you know what, we don't have to, we're wrestling with them, but we get to win because of the victory. It says, if you look at a few verses preceding this, verse 9, it says that in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. How many believe it still does? And how many realize that we are part of his body too, right? And that's the good news. It says, you are complete in him, Colossians 2:10, which is the head of all principality and power. And so, oh man, when you start to come into this revelation, it'll make you more than a conqueror, you know, over those things that have been defeating you in the past. And I still got things I'm working on too, so keep me lifted up. But the Lord, you know what? Will he find faith when he comes? How many believe that he should find every one of us contending, standing against these forces that are, whether it's a financial thing or a physical thing or mental or spiritual, it doesn't matter, right? We need somebody to be believing. Hallelujah. And so while our Lord was on the earth, he demonstrated this fact that he was the seed of the woman that crushed the enemy's head. Acts 10:38 reveals how God anointed him with the Holy Ghost and with power, how he went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil because God was with him. He did this just like you and I will do it through him, through the Holy Spirit, right? God is with us. He's near. The kingdom's at hand. I'm telling you, that's some good news. And so you see how God was with him, but yet when he was with his disciples, when he was walking as a man on the earth, you see that he was kind of laying the groundwork for greater things to come. He started giving them authority. Luke chapter 9, it says he gave his disciples power and authority over all the devils, that they could cure diseases. I mean, that's pretty cool that they could preach the gospel. Right? Luke 10:19. I bring these out just because grace comes through the word, right? Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word. I'm believing there's some grace being released here, and we're going to get into some more. Luke 10:19 says he gives us power to tread on the serpents and scorpions. So in other words, we get to bruise the enemy's head too. We get to walk in the victory of Jesus. Isn't that cool? How many is okay with that? Yeah, yeah. Got to see some of that this morning. Praise the Lord. It was a good day. Yeah. Over all the power of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall hurt you. And then he goes on, because they came back and they were all excited. They're saying, Master, even the devils are subject to us in your name. And what name has been given to us? The name of Jesus, right? And he says, don't rejoice because they're subject to you, but rather because your names are written in heaven. There's something about the sons of God. He knows all of us. He knows everything about all of us. I'm really going to get into that next week. I like what it says. These are things that I try to live in and I practice. I speak these out. Romans 16:20 says, the God of peace. Didn't God give us peace through Jesus Christ? Reconciliation, right? Rest. It says, the God of peace shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. And it says the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the divine ability of our Lord Jesus Christ will be with you. Amen. How many believe he is with us? When you know he's with you, it changes. It will change the way you face the enemy. You'll have a greater, you'll have something within you to deal with these things when you know he's in you and with you, because you have the revelation of the word by the Spirit. It produces that ability. I'm telling you what, I really believe the Lord's going to open some doors in the days ahead, and that if we'll just step through those doors of opportunity, you're going to see him through humility. You're going to see him empower you to rise to the occasion, whatever it may be. There is going to be some great grace released in the days ahead. Several other places in the Bible, we find verses that reveal Christ is the seed of the woman referred to in Genesis 3:15. But also that he gives those who live by faith, you know, power over all the enemy. And so we've seen that. Let me just give you another couple of verses. I want to encourage people today. It says that if you've been born again in 1 John 5:4, that you overcome the world. And what is the victory that overcomes the world? Faith, right? He should find us overcoming when he comes. Hallelujah. Yeah. In other words, he didn't leave us alone. You know, he is here and he is near. I'm telling you what, when the enemy tries to come at you with stuff, he'll come in like a flood and wash them away, blow them away. Okay, hallelujah. Let's just look at a couple more verses. I mean, you see Jesus doing things in the flesh, you know, ministering to the, you know, to his nation, the Jews first. But when he came, you know, on the day of Pentecost, he came in such a way that's going to make it available for all of us to have God with us in a greater way. In fact, you know what? There's going to be an explosion of his glory in the days ahead when the manifestations of the sons of God start coming forth. The enemies, they know what's coming. You know, it says in Scripture they would never have crucified the Lord if they knew what was going to happen. How many's, yeah, okay with that? And so you see what he did. You know, before he left us on this earth, he did not leave us alone. But you know what? He made a way for us to be with him, and he's going to be with us. He said in Matthew 28:18, and he said, all power is given to me in heaven and earth. He says, go teach all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things, whatever I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. He's with us right now. Oh, man. Mark's version of the Great Commission, I just love this, you know. You know, let me just read a verse, verse 14, if you have your Bibles. Look at verse 14 first. I mean, he appeared to his disciples as they sat down and ate, and he upbraided them, you know, with their unbelief and hardness of heart because they didn't believe those eyewitnesses that saw him risen. Oh, man. How many believe that God expects us to take him at his word? To believe that this is the word of God, that he is a rewarder of those who believe it, that seek after him. You're going to see faith come, right? Oh, yeah. And then he said, go. You know, here is a great commission into all the world. Preach the gospel everywhere. And it says, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved, but he that doesn't believe is going to be damned. And these signs, that's a word for people that aren't born again. He doesn't want you to perish. I don't know, maybe somebody's watching this, but you know what? He so loved the world. God is, Jesus is our best friend, the sinner's best friend. How many realize that? He came, he took their place and made a way for them to escape the bondage of sin and darkness and all this stuff that we did in the world. Oh, man. He doesn't want anybody to perish. But if they don't want to believe, they don't have to. But who wouldn't want to when you know, right? It says, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved, shall be delivered, shall be set free, healed, blessed. Everything that's in this Bible, right? He that believes not shall be damned, and these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils, they shall speak with tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. And then, after the Lord spoke to them, he was taken up, received into the heavens, where he sat at the right hand of God. That's the power. He's seated at the hand of power. And they went forth. They got the revelation, preached everywhere. It says, the Lord was working with them, confirming the word with signs following. I think we're starting to get the revelation, the church corporately. You know, I know there's people that are walking in great faith. Don't take it the wrong way. But I believe, I'm looking at my own self, that we're just starting to come into this revelation that he really is with us. This really is the word of God. He is near. He is closer than a brother, even. I mean, our Lord, he's so close that you can become one with him. His life can become your life. In fact, I've been hearing that word symbiotic. Anybody ever heard that word symbiotic before? That's what the Lord is saying. You guys, I mean, realize our life is dependent upon his life. When we come into that revelation, we're in a place, we're in a position to experience real breakthrough. And it's through relationship. Hallelujah. And so they got the revelation in their generation. They stepped into faith. But I believe the Lord has put it on my heart to start stirring people today that we too are part of that generation. Their generation and our generation, we are part of that generation. I'm going to get into that in the future here. We're part of even that 42nd generation in Matthew 1:17. Okay. All right, is this stirring anybody? In retrospect of all the things the Lord has done for us, when he comes, is he going to find faith? Oh man, just look at a lot of the people in the world, and it seems like, the enemy has sidelined so many people. They're not really getting it. But God wants us all to get it. So I think there's going to be some shaking. There's going to be some stirring. There's going to be some fresh grace release. Things that are there in the Word, he's going to bring them forth afresh in this generation. How many believe that? Oh, yeah. And so, wow. I can't really go too much longer here, but he is with us. Will he find faith when he comes? I'm telling you what, that's a sobering word. And here's something even more sobering. He's already come. He's already here. And are we in faith? If we're not, the good news is we can start stepping into faith, right? We really can. And I'm really going to dig deeper into this. I can't go into a lot of detail today, but I got so much revelation on this. I'm going to leave you with something. Let me just chew on this one for a minute here. Isaiah 9:6, talking about the Son that's been given. Isaiah 9:6. Is this stirring you a little bit today? It says, "For unto us a child is born. Unto us a son is given." He's been given, right? "And the government shall be upon his shoulders. His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." And why does it say Everlasting Father there? Has anybody ever thought about that? Is that the same Father as the eternal Father God, or is there something else there? And I'm suggesting to you that there is something else that's going to come forth out of the church in the days ahead. I believe that I had a dream on this again, that we are in that time in the book of Revelations where you see the woman appear and the moon's under her feet. I think that's the way it goes. And anyway, she's with child, and she gave birth to a man child, right? And this is, I think that this is tying in with what we're talking about. I had a dream of this the other night, and then Genevieve started talking to me about this guy named Lance Wallnau. He was talking about the same kinds of things, that this lady, this which is believed to be the church in some circles, some believe it's the nation of Israel, but I believe it's the church, is giving birth to this child within. And in other words, there's going to be something that is begotten of Jesus. It's not going to be in us, but it's going to be Christ in us. And the enemy is going to be so upset about it that he's going to make war with this seed, with the remnant. These people are going to be like no other people there has ever been for centuries. I mean, they're going to be so sold out. They're going to be overcoming by the blood of the Lamb. and the word of their testimony. They're not going to love their lives unto the death even. Right? And it says there was a great war in heaven. The angels were fighting with the fallen ones, and the fallen ones did not prevail. This is in Revelation 12. But they were booted out of the second heaven, and they've come upon the earth. And I think that's why we're seeing such an acceleration of persecution and darkness coming on the earth, because the devil knows that he doesn't have that much time, and there's a and what, you know, all this is going to produce that greater reality is going to come forth, right? We're going to have to make a way for that greater reality to come forth in the days ahead, right? Because that's what the Bible says. We are overcomers, right? And they're going to not love their life unto death, and they're going to, oh man, they're going to blow the devil up. It's going to be a bad thing for the devil. I'll just say it that way. Aren't you glad? But could it be that God is doing something in you and all of us right now in this time? And that word Father there, I'm going to kind of really dig into that. And there's some revelation in the Old Covenant that I'm going to bring out next week. I hope you come back. I don't mean to leave you hanging on with a cliffhanger here, but come back, because this is there's some real powerful revelation that connects you to Christ. And we see, you know, scripture after scripture that says we are members of His body, right? We are part of the household of God. We are members in particular. What does that mean? And we are, God has done more in us than we may realize. And he's going to open it up in the days ahead. I think there's going to be some real fresh revelation coming on the church. And there's so much that I want to get into, but that's all I can say right now. I'll just close with Psalms 110, and Psalms 110, I think that's where that is. I'm just going to quote it from memory. It says, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit thou on my right hand till I make all thy enemies thy footstool." Talking about our Lord Jesus Christ, that's where He is. What that means to us, the good news of all that is if we belong to Christ, we are Abraham's seed, right? And our enemies are His enemies. And if we'll just let the Holy Spirit have His way, He's going to bring them all down. He's going to put them all under our feet, right? How many believe that? And you're going to see that Christ within you come forth like never before in the days ahead. So I hope that this stirs you up. Don't miss next week. If you missed last week, it kind of builds into this. Let me encourage you, go get it. I mean, there's some real revelation there that I believe can bless you. And I'm going to put it on our website this week and make copies. And so, praise the Lord. So let's close out. You have communion? Is that what you said? Yeah. Amen. So, yeah, if you got anything, maybe people are watching, you know, we're just receiving communion, but you can repent right where you are and just confess your sins. He is faithful to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. If you want to receive Jesus as your Lord, just ask, say, Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. Come into my life, save me, be my Lord. And I believe You died on the cross, You rose from the dead on the third day, and He will do that. He is faithful to do that. And if you're watching online and you want to sow a seed in our ministry, there you can do that on our website. We want to pray a blessing on that as well. Thank you for joining us today. May the Lord richly bless you. Hallelujah.